Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Hashtag Ask Jochen. This is the online live stream series that we do every single week. And we just collect all of your questions and we spend an hour here with Jochen. And he answers all of your saddle fitting questions live. So thank you for joining us again. So this is always on Facebook and YouTube, usually every Thursday at 5 p.m. Eastern. But today we just had a little exception because Jochen's schedule is getting a little bit busy. So we switched it to Wednesday for this week. But typically you will find us every Thursday at 5. So we're just waiting to see you guys pooling in here on YouTube and Facebook. And I'm just going to double check. Yeah, perfect. So if you guys could drop us in a little comment, letting us know where you're from, where you're watching from, and if you have any questions or comments, we always love reading through them and we'll get to as many questions as we can in this session. And as always, if we don't get to your question, we'll answer it in the next session and they just keep rolling over. So that's perfect. Let's move forward without any further ado to our introduction sequence and then welcome Jochen to the show.
Hello, welcome. Everybody.
Welcome, Jochen.
How are you today?
I'm great. How are you?
It's always looking for answers is a good slide to start, wouldn't you say?
Totally. Definitely.
There's so many people and I know we could speak for hours and hours. So I'm going to go really super fast. I have a little timer here. It's already running, you know, so I won't make my intro too long. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce myself quick for those folks who haven't met me yet or haven't seen one of my live streams before. My name is Jochen Schlaeser. I'm passionate about horses and to protect them from long-term damage. I needed to look besides myself being a rider. This was my favorite horse and my best friend. And I had to retire him early because of saddle fitting issues. What back then was unable to detect was just opinion, rather than really figuring out the cause. Because the bizarre part is the problem was in front of the saddle, was on the shoulder blade, the scapula. So while the veterinarians back then in 78 to 81, that's when we were fighting with the issues, had all the best intention, but they didn't have the tools what they have today. And sure, we changed saddles and sure we looked for it, but little did I know how much or how important it is to pay attention to what side the mane falls, because that right there tells you if your horse is left-handed or right-handed, and you need to particularly pay attention to the side where the mane is pushed away from it. So I made myself a promise that nobody should lose their best friend, their horse, because of not knowing what they don't know. So I surrounded myself with experts from all around the world. Here, one of Europe's best professors at the University of Vienna, Zurich, and in Germany, Dr. Wolfgang Meyerhofer. He specializes in acupuncture and chiropractic. So I wanted to ask the experts rather than opinions. I wanted to go with science. And as I said earlier, back then in 78, they didn't have the science. You know, we have now MRIs, fiber optic cameras, computerized saddle pads, thermography, and the list goes on and on and on. And the veterinarians, most of the time, have the best interest for their horse. You know, so just like in any other sports, there's one or the other person who rather goes the short way. But I wanted to find people who dedicate their life and educate themselves and the industry on the well-being of the horses. Other veterinarians, they look on top of the horse's back. They say, look who's that person on, how he's riding. Look how crooked this person sits. Maybe you should look not only at the horse. So this veterinarian, he specializes in looking at the horse's training. How does a horse get trained? There's different opinions, different methods, and he explains it so well that there are certain ways you can cripple the horse very fast. What has that to do with saddles? Well, you see the picture on the top left here, the horse will have severe problem in the lumbar region and will get more a hollow sway back. And that's of course a complete different back to fill. And as of well, he says, well, there's different gender now who rides, you know, female riders versus male riders. Veterinarians, as I mentioned earlier, have now tools such as fiber optic cameras, and they have all kinds of cool thermographies. And what I'm very honored is that they used our philosophy, Saddle Fit for Life, as educational arm from Schleser, and teaches now to other veterinarians in various university schools. And saddle fitting is not just for the dressage rider or the jumper. Now imagine we can prove to you, if you're in the racing industry, that horses can actually perform much better, less injury, larger strides per minute, less speed per minute. So if the horse can actually perform better, that's what really counts. So we can wait until he's dead and we can look at the anatomy. Here's another veterinarian who is really, really well known in the UK, in the States, and subsides now in South Africa. She can clearly demonstrate the damage saddles can cause and the deformity to the skeleton of the horse. So if we have now veterinarians from all around the world who make it very, very clear, why don't we listen to them? Why can saddle makers, riders, trainers not understand that this is not based on opinion, this is on science? If you don't want to wait until your horse is dead and then have your horse dissected and then somebody tells you based on the deformity on the horse's bone, see, I told you so, maybe you can listen to this veterinarian. This veterinarian wrote an equine journal on the facial expression. You know, we all know, you know, there's a lot of stories, but she made herself this as a task and she wrote that, you know, horses speak. Horses don't know how to lie. Look at the eyes, the ears, the mouth, and they can see right there, oh, there is maybe a problem. And I also see my timer is off, so I want to make sure. Yeah, I got still 4 minutes. So, and based on everything I learned through all the last 42 years, I decided to write a book. So horses don't need to ride or be ridden and they're suffering and they don't need to suffer silence. No, so saddle fitting, so many people have so many opinions, but there's science. Sure, there's people who are sponsored, but do they really know what they're talking about, or do they just get a big paycheck? There's a lot of about nature. You know, if I put a girth in a wide area of the horse's belly, the girth will go to the narrow spot. So I call it the law of nature. And then don't forget the cognitive dissonance. You know, that means I know something that's wrong on my saddle, but I'm going to lie to myself because I can deal with that better. I've deep down my gut and in my soul, I'm miserable because I know my saddle doesn't fit the horse and I'm hurting it. So this book here brought to the attention that something dramatically changed over the last 40 years. The breeding has changed dramatically. As I mentioned already, we have the majority of the riders are now female riders. So how saddles are made are completely different than 30, 40 years ago. And then we don't have the horse just for war or for work. We have them also as sport. And part of the breeding is we have horses now who are not like in the old days, rectangle. They have upright rectangle backs, very, very short backs. And they have very, very long legs. And that creates a massive problem when you talk about saddle fitting in terms of the saddle length. You cannot, sure you can, but not to the detriment of the horse. You cannot put a saddle on the shoulder blade. It has been shown various videos, various articles, not by saddle makers, by veterinarians who dissected horses, how the tree can literally cripple the horse for life. And the same in the back. You cannot ever put the saddle too far back. Okay, so, and what one of my favorite books is written by Dr. James Worson, and he makes it very clear. You know, he makes it very clear. There's a massive difference between a male and female pelvis. And no other sport, rather than in riding, is where man and female compete against each other. And over thousands of years, a man made a saddle for a man. But as I mentioned, over the last 40 years, the demographic changed. You know, we have a lot of ladies who ride now, but the base is still made to the male pelvis. So if the male pelvis is so much difference, and I ignore that, then the rider will have problems. And this is a quote from the Spanish Riding School, but clearly said, it's of the utmost importance not to cause the pupil any discomfort. Because the rider will create a cramped seat. Cramped posture, it's impossible to get a pliable seat. That means the rider is soft in the seat. And it says very clear, if the saddle doesn't fit the horse, the horse will suffer pain. So saddle fitting, and what I'm going to do today to answer your question, is to hopefully make it a little bit easier, transparent. The skeleton of the tree, saddle, is the saddle tree. So how the tree, the skeleton of the saddle matches your skeleton, male or female, huge difference, to the skeleton of the horse, it's absolutely important. Only then, if I fit this correctly, we all have a true partnership. A true partnership, because most people do love their horses, and then most people want the best for the horses. If you're an Olympic rider, if you're a pleasure rider, if you're a recreational rider, it really, really, really doesn't matter. And at the end of the day, all of these factors changes the horse's back, and saddle fitting is nothing else than to make sure we realign the spine of the horse with the spine of the rider without causing any long-term damage. So here at Schleser, we make saddles in various forms and shapes and make them in all different sizes. And we're here for you now. So this rest of the hour is now yours. And Mary Claire, look at that. 3 seconds to go.
Wow, impressive. Amazing job, Jochen. Thank you. So we have a lot of questions and they're already starting to pool in. And I just want to say thank you, Michaela, for your amazing question. We will get to that in a little bit. There's just another question I wanted to ask Jochen, which was asked on Instagram today. And I think it's an amazing question because he just kind of segued into it, actually. So this is from Shaylin Mattson on Instagram. And she says, what Schleser saddle would you recommend for a horse with a very small saddle support area? And she did not specify what discipline. So I figured you could probably talk about each discipline if that's okay with you. Yeah.
Okay. So we always look at the relation rider to horse. So if, let's say, the horse on the bottom would have a 16-inch saddle support area, that is considered small, but not to the rider if the rider is that size. Isn't that cute, Mary Claire? Look at how cute the rider. I think that's actually taking us up by an island.
No way. Oh, yeah, maybe.
That's where you would live right now.
Yeah.
So, but sometimes myself, I'm 6'3", and I'm very tall, very skinny, have long, long legs. And sometimes when I sit on the horse, my lower legs don't even come close to the body. And we have to fit the tall rider sometimes to a horse with a short saddle support area. So saddle support area is in relation to the rider, short, okay, or long. So on the bottom right, obviously we have a lot of saddle support area for the small person. So let's assume we're talking about, we have a rider who needs a 17.5-inch seat, which means the front to back saddle, like where this nail is measured, is 17.5. And the horse's back only measures 16 inches. So let's say most people know that from the nail to the cantle is where all English saddles gets measured. Now a Western saddle, if this question goes towards a Western saddle, a Western saddle gets measured from index finger to where my thumb is right here. Okay, so they don't have a nail and they don't measure to the concho, which would be down here. So this in the English saddle, the seat measurements is what we call the tree measurement. That would be measured from pommel to cantle. So when somebody says, I have a horse with a small saddle support area, and I can't sit in a tiny, tiny saddle, what saddle does the Schlese have? Then I instantly look at this front part of the saddle here. We call that the pommel. The pommel, let me show you a tree. Okay, so you can see here, this is the pommel. I'm gonna put a ruler on top so you can all see. This is where the front of the nail would be, right there. And the nail would be measured to the back of the saddle. So if this is 17 and a half, doesn't matter where I put the nail, the rider feels the rise and the fall, and the rise and the fall in the back and in the front. Where I put the nail, it really doesn't matter. So saddle trees come in different pommels. Full cutback, or 5-inch cutback, quarter cutback, snub nose, straight head. Let me show you what a straight head looks like. Straight head means right where the nail is, that pommel edge starts. So it's really, really straight in front. So that's what we call a straight head pommel. So that is probably the largest seat space you have. And with the nail from seat to cantle, it measures the same distance. If you have a saddle, you say, yeah, but I want a saddle with a big cutback. You will have a very long saddle on the bottom and still a small seat on top. So what I recommend, what type of Schlese, any type of saddle from Schlese what has not a cutback. We have anything from a quarter cutback, so that would be a little bit less, snub nose or straight heads. So look at all this space in front here, what is dead area. In addition, what I recommend, we have Schlese saddles with shoulder relief. That means that this tree point really goes far back. Let me show you what that means. So you can see on some saddles where this point really goes far back. Why is that so important? The shoulder blade, this is the upper arm, this is shoulder blade. Okay, wherever that ends is where that saddle starts. So now with the tree point, what goes further back, we have more space. So let me show you how that looks on the saddle. You can see how much this is cut back here. So it's important that you lift up and you can actually see where the tree point is and it goes backwards. Sometimes you gotta be careful. Sometimes the tree goes forward, but the panel goes back. So I would recommend to push with your thumb against it and try to find where this edge is. So if you have a saddle with a very short pommel and a shoulder relief panel, and then the back of the saddle does not have an extender. You can see in the slide here, it has an extender, okay? You only need that if you are super, super heavy on a very, very large horse. But if the horse has the lumber here, don't have the extenders, okay? Have the saddle panel finished where it ends. So you end up with the same size with the horse's back support area is, because one more time, you feel this space, cantle to pommel. You do not feel where that saddle nail is. So on an English saddle, make sure, oops, my joint falls apart. Make sure that you do not go with a full cutback pommel, and we have the whole binate line. So if you go on our website, you see the binate line, then the HK, so these are dressage. Hardly ever you see a jumping saddle with the full cut. So if you talk about a jumping saddle, you're pretty safe. If you talk about a Western saddles, all our Western saddles are completely adjustable on the bottom. We have a split bar That means the Western tree, the old traditional Western tree, has rawhide and big, thick wood covered. Ours, we have very, very thin material, much, much stronger and lighter than rawhide or wood. And we can split it. That means one part sits to the top to the rider and the bottom one can be exchanged. So you can have whatever saddle length or bar length you require for the horse.
Excellent. Awesome. Thanks, Jochen. I think we actually answered Michaela's question with that question. So it was very similar question. So that's perfect. Two birds with one stone.
Wow.
Let's move on with one more question. This is from Facebook before we take another question from YouTube because we're seeing them continue to roll in. So this is from Alexis on Facebook. And she says, what is your best advice to someone who can't afford to purchase a new saddle, but wants to do right by their horse? Are there any short-term fixes to help improve saddle fit?
Okay, so it depends on the type of problem. There's 11 areas where the saddle has to fit. Okay, if the saddle is too long, there's nothing you can do to have a pad or can have somebody stuff your saddle. It just won't work. Kind of like somebody says, okay, you're getting blood blisters on your toes and on your heel, and you keep tripping over your feet because your shoes are two sizes too small. And then you're gonna say, but please, I need to do something quick. Can I buy an insole or special socks, or can you widen my shoes? If the shoe doesn't fit, no matter what you do, and socks or pads, it won't work. And with the length of the saddle, same thing. If the problem is not the length, if it's a balance issue, then most of the time they're very, very good shim pads. You can help yourself out. But the big, big watch out is make sure the shim pad is attached to the saddles. The saddle pads where you can use shims are wonderful. Okay, they're really good so long they're attached to the saddle. Why is that so important? I'll give you another example with shoes. Sometimes you get orthotics, and these orthotics are because your knee issues, hip issue, or your foot, how it's grown. So the orthotics would never be in thongs or flip-flops or in open-toe shoes or open-heel shoes. Why? Because the orthotic would slide around, and it would really, really give you massive back problems, foot, knee, or hip pain. So every orthotic will be in a closed shoe so it doesn't move around. Same with the shin pad. If the shin pad moves and there's always shoulder movement, the horse does walk, trot, canter, there's always movement under your saddle, okay? There's not enough, you can't tighten the saddle tight enough because there is movement on the horse's back, even with a super tight girth. So if the shin pad, which does move around, you have more problem than you ended up after than you started with. So do not use shim pads unless you can secure it to the saddle, to the D-ring with straps or with Velcro or with any kind of a ways so the shim pad doesn't move. The other alternative is many, many saddles have what we call wool stuff panel. So I'm gonna take that screen sharing out so it's easier to see. So when I take the panel off a saddle, you end up with a separate piece. Compare that to the car when you put your car on top of the block and you take the tires off. So these parts of a saddle, we call them panels. And the panels have gullet leather. This is the leather here, what is stitched together. What comes from the bottom and it wraps around. So let's say you have a saddle, what is really narrow for the spine. So you see one finger clearance. Okay? Your saddle maker, saddle fitter can open the seam and make that area larger. Sometimes the problem is it decreases the weight bearing surface here. So it becomes very narrow, like you see here. Okay? And sometimes you can just stitch it on and stitch it further apart. So the space underneath the saddle I'm going to show you now how the saddle looks with the panel on. Okay. If you have a saddle, everything is fine, but your veterinarian says it's really, really bad, or your chiropractor, this is too narrow for your horse's spine. This needs to come off and set to the side. Now, you can't do this yourself. You need a saddle maker or somebody who's trained, so that you have a minimum of a man's fist space. Anything narrower than that will cause long-term damage to the horse. These are not my words. This is studies and research and papers shown numerous times, because just like you, horses have spinal nerves. And if you ride around the corner or you rest right, hacking, and the saddle sits on those spinal nerves, the horse will react, and that causes severely spinal problems. So to summarize it up, it does not always have to be a new saddle. Sometimes a used saddle could be just as good. You know, or we call them pre-loved, pre-owned saddles. So a good used saddles, they don't cost the world. There sometimes could be an answer. Careful with pads, so long they are not attached, stay away from shin pads. And if the saddle is too long, do not attempt to fit it. Just get a new horse or a new saddle. Billets, what type of billets to use? It helps you a lot with shifting or twisting saddles. That's why saddles have adjustable billets, or sometimes three billets on one side. I know this is a very vague answer, but it's a very big question, because I said there could be 11 different ways how a saddle doesn't fit. Sometimes people say, yeah, but it's just a little high in the front. You're just a little high in the front and you fall back and you just stuff something in the back, the cantle raisers they call it. Let me see if I have one of those lollipops or cantle raisers. They are momentarily good for you. So they just sit in the back and this closes the channel. So you created a new problem, you got the balance, and now you have every pressure on the spine. Second problem, the saddle sits in the back, but bridging in the middle. Now you've created a new problem, which is bridging, which is probably the worst thing a saddle panel can do, which means it just sits on four corners, the front and the back two corners. So unfortunately, these type of saddle pads are really, really bad. This is a wither lifter. These are really bad. When you go with saddle pads, go with pads what can be shimmed. Here's one, it has pockets. And you see here, it has a loop attached to the saddle so it doesn't slide. Make sure that your pads, if you use it to fit, has attachment loops. Otherwise, as I said, it moves around. And if it doesn't sit on the red area, it sits, goes forward into the shoulder or on the spine, or you decrease the spinal clearance, especially in the back. You're not doing the horse any help, because all these little spurs here, spinal processes, you know, they are like the princess and the pea. The horse feels it and it gets very tight in the back. Unfortunately, sometimes I make it worse than good.
Great answer, Jochen. Thank you. Yeah, I know that is a really large question and it's very vague, but it is something that we do hear a lot. Like a lot of people ask it, so I figured it's always great to answer it.
I want to look at I lost it. Here we go. If I make that larger, mm-hmm. and see if I can put it in. No, that won't play with me. Go ahead. I got to fix my live show here.
Okay. So the next question we have is will be from Peyton, and he just asked this question on he or she just asked this question on YouTube. So, sorry, were you still speaking about this subject, or are you okay to move on to the next?
I know question? It's just that I wanted to show the all the different the lengths, the balance, the rotation. You know, the tree width. If the tree is too narrow, I mean, that goes back to the shoe. If the tree is too narrow, what pad can you do? You know, so it's as mm-hmm. much as I want to help, I would always get an advice. There's long distance fitting kit we do now. Doesn't cost you anything. You can download it from the website, and then we can help you to guide you through and hopefully find a quick solution. So check us out online, our online professional long distance. That definitely gets you a step further before you do anything what may cause a bigger problem.
Right. And like Jochen said, it's completely free. So there's really nothing holding you back from even just getting to understand more about Saddle Fit too, and watching the videos and doing the steps yourself. So that's a really great resource for sure. So the next question from Peyton, he says, how can the average rider buying a secondhand saddle know that a saddle has been made for a male or a female rider? Is it the silhouette of the saddle?
There is 9 main features, and yes, the silhouette of the tree is one of them. It's actually the main thing, but it's a good starting point if you look at the top of the seat, the seaming. Okay, so let me try to find some pictures first, and then I'm going to show you 2 saddles, which is very obvious. So when I look at these 2 pelvises, you see how the front part of this male pelvis, this is what we call the pubic symphysis, way totally free in the pommel, okay? And here, the vertebrae is level. So this is what we call the neutral position in the human's body. I need to be able to pivot my pelvis forward and back. So this is neutral when the vertebrae is level. And you can see the pubic symphysis is away, and these side bones called the pubic branches. On the ladies, the seat bones are much wider, side bones are down, and also the pubic symphysis is down. You see there is no space here. You also see here it's level. Compare this to that. And that is just the way the birth channel is on the lady. If I put that in a cast, the front pubic symphysis will hit. Seat bones are much wider on the female. Male seat bones are narrow and no contact there. So if I'm looking at the shoulder, hips, and heels, there's always this extra space in the back. On the male, none, because guys have long tailbones. Check it out. Long tailbones, ladies short tailbones. So the first thing you can look at the saddle, you can say, is there enough support under my tailbone? Okay, so very often right here, where number 5 is, guys have a more hollow, like shallow seat, more hollow. Then the next area where number 4 is, yeah, that was the first pictures I showed you where the bones are far, far away, okay? So that is the area where you see a very narrow seam. And right here where the round ball is here, this is where the seat foam is very pointy in the front. So if I'm looking at a saddle and I say, how do I know it's a male or female? The best way, this is a typical male saddle. How can you tell? You can tell that the seam is very narrow together and this area is very roofy. Roofy means if I put a ruler on, it's very pivoting. Okay, so this here is purposely built like my hand, like a roof. So this cuts into the rider's crotch. So his parts go left or right. So let's pretend for a minute that the flat area, the base of the pelvis of an average adult rider is 5 inches wide and you sit in the middle. Look where my pinky is. My pinky is right here at the front. Let me take that screen out so it's a little bit easier to see. So where my, if this is the middle of the saddle, my pinky is right here at the seam. Typical a male seat has in this area no more than 1 or 2 finger max, maybe 1.5 finger width. What would that be, an inch? An inch and a quarter at the most, okay? So if this is very narrow, typical for a guy because that creates that roof. In the back here where the, if I put my hand on it again, 5 inches where my thumb is, that's very often where the edge of this flap is. So if I go across here, that very often is narrow to medium, less than 8 inches across, because the guy has narrow seat bones. So if I put this male on the saddle, you can see the seat bones are inside the seam. You can see the pelvis, the vertebrae is level. And you can see there's space in the crotch, and he can lean all the way forward, okay, before he hits the bones. And keep in mind, we guys, we can put our pads left or right. So if I say, well, I can only afford one saddle, my wife and my daughters have to ride in my saddle, okay? But their pelvis is differently, okay? They will hit first, like you see in the picture or on the cast, with the bone. And then the seam, you sit right there on the seam right there, okay? You sit where it's really, really rubbing your underwear. So typical male saddle, a female saddle, let's say you pick one of those up. Same thing, you look where the middle is, put your hand, spread it, look where your pinky is. Right there you can see the distance is much, much wider, at least 3 or 4 fingers, more than 2 inches. You also see a little bit more support here because the lady has a shorter tailbone. If this would be hollow or low, she would pivot back and always falls in the chair seat. Again, my hand on top where my thumb is, the edge of the flap. There you see typical more than 9-inch seat width. Why? Because the seam and the tree is wider there to support the female pelvis. So if I sit on here and I make that level, you can see there's no way, oopsie, there's no way that lady would ever, ever hit the seaming, and she has support in the back. Now the structural thing, you can't see, but on the lady, the structural saddle all have a cutout, because no lady wants to sit on the rooftop. They want to have a collapsed area. This is where Schlaeser made his money, 1996. I patented this tree, which has a CC that stands for crotch relief. So the best way, without taking the saddle completely apart, you see the seaming spacing in the front and in the back, right here and right there, which is very, very visible between these two saddles without taking the saddle apart. There are 9 features, but that's then more structural.
Awesome, thanks Jochen. So we're getting more and more questions, which is a good thing because we can always use more, but we are plowing through them and we are currently have 20 minutes left. So thank you guys for all your questions. We really appreciate it. Please feel free to keep posting them and keep sharing this live stream to your friends and on your page if this interests you. So let's move on quickly to another one from YouTube. And this is from Amber, Amber Kale. And she says, what would you recommend to someone who's interested in studying equine health and wellness relating to saddle fit and wants to take the next step towards achieving their goals?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have 3 young ladies now hired at Schlaeser from the University of Guelph who did the degree in the equine research. And we also, as I mentioned before, use the educational arm from Schlaeser, which is Saddle Fit for Life. What I recommend, you don't have to become a saddle maker or saddle fitter, but we created this academy, saddlefitforlifeacademy.com, okay? There are courses, you can be certified and you can do this on the side, or you can have this as a full-time, and it's all online. And the cool part is there's some are for free and some of the short courses. And Julia Alebrand down here, she's from the University of Guelph. And you're more than welcome to give her email her and ask her, hey, Julia, can you please tell me how was your university? What did you do there? And how does Saddle Fit for Life compare to that? So if you don't want to go to university and you want to stick to saddle fitting and you want to get yourself more educated, look at all these wonderful courses. You can really learn here. And the price is really not high if you consider how much one or the other professional cost. So if you're really interested in that, I recommend check these out. There's a wonderful videos and online courses, or you have also the opportunity to buy our book, my book. And that is also, it's $26. And it's our educational book. Let me see if I have even one. I think I mentioned that earlier. So this one here has a recommended reading list on the back page from other veterinarians and other, equine specialists who say, you know, the interface between human and horse, the saddle, is such a vital instrument. It's so important. But rather than base it on, if you base it on opinion, then you don't really have any research. You should have it based on science. I wrote this book together with other professionals who have years and years studied the horse or the human. And they say, you know, you can do it this way or that way because somebody has sponsored in the saddle, or you can do it what nature intended, you know, and you can do it so you don't hurt your horse and the horse doesn't hurt like this. So my recommendation, check out our online academy and or call Julia or email her, Julia at saddleacademy.com. And she's more than happy to answer all your questions more in detail.
Awesome. Yeah, Julia is so awesome too. She's a great, great person to talk to. And I'm sure whoever it is that asked that question, like if you pursue equine education, you're going to love it. And especially with Saddle Fit for Life, there's so many great lectures, like video lectures and great content on there for you to check out. So yeah, for sure, look into it. So our next question comes from Instagram. Oh, sorry, I got cut off there. I think you can hear me now. Our next question comes from Instagram, and this is from Angie. And it's another saddle fitting question. And it's, what does it mean if my saddle twists or shifts from one side to one side while I'm riding?
Yeah. So first of all, we need to figure out where does the problem originate? Sometimes it can come from you have a defective product. The saddle tree is twisted. So there's also on the Saddle Fit for Life Academy, a wonderful series on that. If it's not up yet, but there will be a video lecture on that, how you recognize your saddle is twisted. So let's pretend your saddle is not twisted. Most saddle makers, if I find a tree here, when they buy saddle trees, and most of the time it's a wood tree, these bars here is where your stirrup leather hangs on it, and they make sure that this is absolutely level to the ground and to make sure that the tree is not twisted or torqued. So as I said, let's pretend this here for a second is your saddle tree is all okay. Humans don't have the organs absolutely in the center. And most humans are right-handed, some are left-handed, and very few are ambidextrous. And even a person who can write and with the left hand and the right hand, right? Even that person has the organs in different places. So what I'm trying to say, when we ride, we sometimes think I'm absolutely straight, but in reality, most of us come a little bit uneven into the saddle. This is why veterinarians recommend check your saddle at least 3, if not 4 times. You don't have to have a professional doing it. You can do it yourself by having somebody standing behind the horse when you ride away from them on a nice straight line. I recommend doing that in the rising trot. Don't do it in the walk, because one leg is down and the horse always moves. Maybe there's a problem on the horse itself, or the horse just holds himself a little bit to the left. So always have somebody viewing you from the back in the rising trot. In the rising trot, because you're standing up and you're on the stirrup bars, this is the metal plate here with these metal bars I was just saying earlier. Okay, so we pretended the saddle is not twisted. And the horse is with all legs up in the air. So that moment in the rising trot, in the trot phase, there's moments where the horse is with all legs off the ground and is holding himself as straight as possible. That's the best way to have somebody videotaping you or looking from the back and from the front, and look at your shoulders, look at your hips, and look at the stirrup leathers. So determine, are your stirrup leather crooked, your shoulders, or is it actually the horse? So if it's the horse, that is the easiest. And I recommend always start with the horse first. And the reason I do that with the horse first is because horses don't have collarbones like humans. And horses move in the wild many, many miles. Okay, they move 20 miles a day, 17 hours they have their head down. And when the wind comes from the back or the rain, they put the butt to that direction. So if the horse grazes on a hill, they always turn the bottom to the weather. So the horse will also on the hill put the leg, but it's to the valley as a standing leg. So if the hill is to the left side, the rain comes from the back, the left leg will be the supporting leg. In the flatland, the horse will always prefer the right leg. Why? Because the horse's appendix, like on humans, is on the right side. So they have support with the right leg, they digest with the right side, and stretch the left leg forward to graze. Now, from the over 160,000 horses we at Schlese have measured, very, very rare do we measure a wild horse like a Mustang, what has been captured and be trained, what grew up uneven. Very rare. They're almost all straight. But captured horses, horses what grew up in captivity and are not on large areas where they can walk at least 20 miles, they're on flatland or just in the paddock, they're 7 out of 10 have one side bigger than the other. This is the upper arm, this is the scapular, and from the scapula in the upper arm, this entire trunk hangs with muscles, not with bones or ligaments. Some horses have the right upper arm different than the left upper arm, or the musculature. If you went to the German training scala to train a horse, you know number 5 is straightness. You have to ride your horse straight. Straight means develop the horse so he bends left and right properly. If you walk on the in the sand, your horse's hoofs are not on two different tracks, like typical on dogs, okay? And the horse bends even left and right. As I said before, horse's appendix is on the right, and they're bending to the, well, to the right is not as comfortable. They have to squish all their guts, and they have to stretch the intercostal muscle. These are the muscles between the ribs. They're not doing that in the first 3 years, because when they digest, appendix on the right, they digest and bend the ribcage out to the right side. That's the reason why most racetracks go to around the left. The horse bends to the right side. They're bending the right ribs. When the vaulting gymnastic on horses, they only go to the left. They're lunging only to the left, because that's the comfortable way for the horse to go. So you can see on this horse B, sometimes it's muscular and sometimes it's structural. So if you have a horse with 3 years looking like that, okay, so let's say you start riding, most time you can identify, the first clue is which side does the mane fall. From 10 horses, 7 manes fall to the right, 2 to the left, and 1 has the mane all the way front to back, falling to the left and the right. So that horse would be even. So to read back to the original question. If your saddle shifts, okay, then what will happen, instead of having even contact left and right on the horse's spine, the saddle will move against the spine, and then there is a lot of red area here. You see all this deformity or the marks on the spine to the part where they have to do spinal surgery. Because what happens is, let me go here first. This is the lumbar area here. This is the thoracic vertebrae. And these holes in between here, they get smaller and smaller. Look at this. This is a normal hole. This gets smaller and smaller. And that's when they get pinched nerves. And that is super, super, super painful for the horse. The overriding dorsal spinal processes or kissing spine, right? That is clearly, and there's many research has been shown, A is genetics, and B is when you ride your horse upside down or have bad saddle fitting. So if I don't stop the shifting, the twisting, I only incur more and more to the part where the horse gets scoliosis either to the left side or to the right. So what causes this? From most of the time, it is the horse, because it doesn't have collarbone. Number two is the rider. And of course there will be a saddle or a product which could be defected and the tree is twisted. So there's multiple ways how to fix it, multiple ways to approach it. And the number one approach are your billets. Okay. So the billets, it's very easy. Wherever the mane is, you need to use the first two billets on the right side, and on the other side, the back two billets. So you have three billets, use the first two on the right where the mane is, and the back two billets on the opposite side. If the mane is to the left, well, then you change it. The mane is to the left, the first two billets on the left you use, and the back two billets on the right. People say, oh my God, then the girth is uneven. Yeah, the horse has no collarbone, and the front limbs are completely separate. So here, okay, so here's horse, a skeleton. Okay, so you can put it together like a puzzle. And on this side, the bone is still here, and here I took it out. It's just, you open it up and you slide it right out. So this part here, the upper arm and the lower leg. So here we have a miniature version of a horse. This is the lower leg. Here we got the upper arm, and here we got the scapula. So this entire front leg, okay, so that is hanging separate from the rump. So from the shoulder blade, and from the upper arm, there's muscles that goes to the trunk. And when one is more developed than the other, that elbow is more forward on one side than the other. And we talked about law of nature, which means if I look at this rib cage here, it's much wider here than there. The girth will always go to the smallest area. So if one area is more forward than the other, the same applies on the bottom, okay? The same applies on the bottom, and your girth will be crooked. So if you go right away from the get-go and you put your girth where nature will put him, okay, in that diagonal area, the saddle will not twist. The saddle doesn't twist, your horse will not be damaged in the spine. If the problem is with you, your chiropractor, your massage therapist, or your osteopath hopefully can fix you. If he cannot fix you, and unfortunately we see this all the time, is a typical when you see this a lot, when a person tries to somehow sit in the saddle, what is not meant for them, like a woman sits on the male saddle, and in order to get one seat bone on, they shift themselves over to one side, and now they sit crooked on top. So the horse might be okay, the saddle might be okay, but the rider is crooked. So this is a very big bone of my contention. it's so important, that you do not try to deform your body or the horse's body. Start off with the proper gender appropriate saddle. That is number one key. And then evaluate your horse and your saddle, how I need to girth it and how I need to pad it or fit the saddle.
Awesome. Thanks, Jochen. And just before we head into our last question of evening, and the hour has already flown by, we have 5 minutes left on our clock, so I'm just going to make this quick. I just want to thank everybody for joining us. And again, if you haven't heard yet about our yearly saddle giveaway, definitely enter that if you haven't already. It is an incredible, incredible opportunity to win a beautiful, brand new Schlese saddle of your choice. So no matter the discipline, no matter what you ride, what saddle you're interested in, this is an incredible opportunity to win a beautiful saddle. So all you have to do is just click the link that I will be posting directly to our website. So that's schlese.com or saddlesforwomen.com. And it'll be the first image that you see on our website that will bring you to our saddle giveaway. And all you have to do from there is just follow us on our socials, and that'll give you 2 full entries into the giveaway. So definitely check that out. And we will be drawing 1 lucky winner December 31st. So that is super exciting. But until then, you have a lot of great chances to sign up. And again, for anyone who doesn't know this, you actually get even more entries the more people you invite into the giveaway too. So if you share it to 10 of your friends, that's actually an additional giveaway into the entry. So check that out. Yeah, it's a really great.
If I have a lot of friends, I could have a lot of entries.
Exactly, and more chances to win. So yeah, it's definitely.
It's great to be popular.
For sure. Definitely. Okay, so let's get into the last question. I don't know if we'll have enough time, Jochen. What do you think?
I'll give it a go.
Give it a go? Awesome. Thanks. Okay, so this is from Lisa on Facebook just now, and she was saying, would love for you to describe upswept panels versus short panels for a short-backed horse.
Yes, so in the old days, we called them banana panels, upswept panels, or we called them a dovetail. And you see them still mainly on the dressage saddles on the Swiss saddle made in Switzerland or in France. And those two saddles, all what it means that the back panels, they really roll up very fast. So I'm going to use this panel as an example. You have a piece of seaming here, right there. Okay, and you see how big the seaming is right there. That determines how far the stuffing goes down. If I make that seaming very, that piece of leather here, we call that panel wedge. If I make that very, very narrow, okay, then the panel will come way up. So let me show you on the saddle. Whee! Too much saddles, saddler down. So here you can see.
Maybe you can turn off the screen share. Oh, awesome. Thanks. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for that tip. You can see the seaming there. There's a very little wedge here. And that means that the seam goes very fast up. So if this would be the horse, they're swept up in the back. As I said, in the old day, they called them banana panels or dovetail. So short panels mean that the saddle is just very, very, very short and it sits here. Okay, so the short panels could be also referred for panels what have a big cutout for the shoulder blade in the front, or when they have both, the swept up, but the contact leaves here. So there could be both saddles in that respect short, but most of the time the swept up panel is when the seam is very, very small in the back.
Awesome. And with that, we will conclude this other episode of Ask Jochen. Thank you so much for joining us for another episode, Jochen. It's always wonderful to spend the hour with you.
Thank you.
And learn from you.
I see you next week.
All right.